All right. Now, Senator Boto de la Rosa said he will testify in the next hearing. Is that correct?
Well, I'm not. I didn't catch that because
Okay.
I had to leave. I had to catch a talk.
All right. Okay. But I think the bigger issue is what happens now. For example, I mean, the former president is facing his own issues. The ICC has said they will use that, right, and take it to the ICC. But what happens locally, Attorney Diokno, now?
That is now in the hands of the Department of Justice and or the Office of the Ombudsman. Mm-hmm. It's up to them. I'm not privy to what they're doing, but they have the power to investigate and to file the charges against those responsible for the war on drugs.
Uh-oh. Now, you were sitting beside former Senator Laila de Lima. Two questions. What was that like? Can you share with us a bit of insight? When Duterte admitted there was a Davao death squad, we know that she was insisting on the Davao death squad. She investigated it when she ran and won for the Senate, and just a few months after was targeted by the Duterte administration. What did you talk about when she heard that?
Well, that's a vindication for Sen Laila. And, you know, I've always admired her, but my admiration for her really increased yesterday, that she was able to maintain her composure and poise, sitting basically right beside this one seat away from the former president.
Oh, who put her in jail, right?
I mean, who put her in jail?
Yeah.
Yes. Talagang, you know, I have so much respect and admiration for her. And I think that the questions that were propounded to her, you know, I was so tempted to say that especially when Senator Estrada was asking her questions, I was so tempted to say Senator Laila de Lima will never use the law or weaponize the law against any other person. Maski siyang naging biktima niyan ng pag-weaponize ng batas, hindi na hindi niya gagamitin yung kanyang kapangyarihan as CHR or the Secretary of Justice just to go after someone because she wants to go after that person. That's why she was so correct in saying, I could not file any charges because witnesses did not want to come forward. And you can imagine how scary it is for a witness in Davao. Yeah. To come forward against Mayor Duterte, who's been in power there for so long.
This is a side story, no? Did they acknowledge each other's presence? Were you able to acknowledge former President Duterte's presence? Kasi magkatabi kayo eh. It was Duterte, somebody was beside Senator Laila and Duterte.
There was I believe, a PNP official.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and then Laila, and then you. Was there a point of acknowledgement among yourselves?
No.
No, not at all. Okay, another question now is this. Let's talk about the police colonel, Grijaldo, who suddenly said in the Senate that he was pulled aside by Representative Abante and Representative Fernandez in the Quadcom, at in effect, kumbaga ininfluensya to agree with Garma's statements na may reward system. Let's talk about that whole situation. Should the two representatives have done that, spoken to a witness behind closed doors, alone before the hearing?
But let me just tell you my own experience with whistleblowers.
Uh-oh.
You know, I've represented whistleblowers for decades already. And we always make sure that the lawyers involved always make sure that we have witnesses who can attest that no intimidation, no coercion took place when we spoke with the witnesses. It's very important because you can expect that allegations like that will come up later on. So what we do as counsel is we not only have witnesses, but we document all our conferences. And may video yan or may audio recording yan. So that later on, if someone says, tinakot nyo, we can show. Itong ebidensya namin, hindi namin tinakot yan. Yan ay kusang loob nilang sinabi sa amin. That's very important. And perhaps that's a lesson that legislators can learn from this incident.
Oh, and should they have called in the lawyer of the police colonel? Should they have done that?
Yes, but I would have done that if I were in their place. You know, I have to say also, Karen, that medyo naawa din ako sa mga PNP witnesses kasi napapagitna sila eh. I can imagine the kind of pressure they're getting from both sides. And that it's really something that they'll have to withstand. Kailangan matibay din ang loob nila.
Okay, so before we go at this point, number one, are you still going to, is there another hearing that you're attending in the Senate?
Yes, I believe so. I'm not sure when the next hearing will happen, but I was directed by the chair, by Senator Pimentel, to submit some documents. And we hope to be able to present a witness, a survivor of an EJK attempt.
You should make that presentation that you made in the Senate available to students. I think that should be taught in class. I think that's a good one. But let's talk about your run. Tumatakbo ka bilang first nominee ng Akbayan Party List. Tumakbo ka na ng Senado noon. Naging masalimuot yon. But tell me about this campaign. Are you more hopeful about this particular race, Atty.?
Well, first of all, I'm so happy to be part of the Akbayan family and to be able to push the legislative platform and agenda of Akbayan. It's very, very much aligned with my own personal agenda. And I really look forward to hopefully fighting for that in Congress together with Congressman Percy Sendanya of Akbayan, who's already sitting, and with our third nominee, Dada Kiram Ismula. I look at what's going to happen in this campaign as it's going to be a very bright and very happy campaign, I believe, because, you know, working with a group like Akbayan, they have people on the ground, they have an operating system for campaigns, and that is something that we will need in order to succeed in 2025.
Now, Attorney Jokno, you've been serving the public for so long as a human rights lawyer. Siguro ang tanong ng ilan, kakayanin niyo po ba ang politika at sinasabi nilang, alam mo, the challenge in the lower house? You'll have over 250 plus congressmen there. You're fighting with a super, super majority. I mean, in the Senate, they're 24. And you see the minority's voice in the Senate. It's shining. But in the lower house, it may not be the same. I mean, what are your thoughts on that?
That's a good question.
Right?
That's going to really to be a test of my character. Yeah. But I have to say that I had to fight similar battles in all my 36 years of practicing law, because in the practice of law, there are a lot of shortcuts made by other lawyers. There are a lot of under the table kind of deals that are done. And I had to go through all of that and make sure that my reputation would remain unsullied and clean. And that's how I am known in the legal profession. So I hope to bring that to Congress together with the other Akbayan nominees.
Well, I do hope you do well, Attorney Shelby Okno. I think you're going to make a difference there. So good luck to you, sir. Good luck.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Karen.
All right. Attorney Shelby Okno running for Akbayan Party List Representative. Thank you.